I love fiction as much as the next guy, and since I like to analyze stuff, mostly real stuff, I also love to analyze made-up stuff. And versus videos are one of my all-time favorites, and I stumbled over that. The Star Trek Borg Cube against the Star Wars Death Star. Link is of course in the description. And I would have let it be, although I don't agree with the conclusion, but then this happens. 90% of you agreed that it would be the Death Star, and sorry guys, I mean in what galaxy and... Okay, let's recap that, okay? I don't go into all the technical details, but the important ones first. The Death Star is 53 times bigger than the Borg Cube and has a lot of fighting crafts on board, but these things have no shields and the shield technology on the side of the Death Star is limited and far inferior to the adaptive capabilities of the Borg. The biggest problem there is that in the Star Wars universe, the shields can be penetrated, a lot of them by just moving pretty slow. But the key element in the story is this mega super duper laser beam of the Death Star that is able to one hit anything. And the assimilation technology of the Borg on the other side. Beside the question of the cube is linked to the hive mind or not, which makes quite a difference, but let's say yes for this instance. First, yes, if you are able to hit the Borg cube with this mega laser, it's toast. And it's toast as much if you hit a car with a 15-inch naval gun. It's just toast. The thing is, you don't do. You see, weapons are made for a purpose. You don't use a lot of bullets to slowly but surely grind your way through a tank, because that's silly. You use an anti-tank weapon for that. And you don't use a 15-inch naval gun to shoot down a plane, not even a big plane, because you're gonna miss. Yes. We saw that the Death Star is able to destroy smaller ships of the Rebels, but the reason they could do that is that the Rebels have the military experience and competence of George Lucas and are therefore pretty incompetent. The Borg are not. They have the collective military experience of about 10,000 species. They would never hover in front of something that looks like the biggest weapon the galaxy has ever seen. They would stay on the other side. And the Borg are clear in the advantage because of their superior maneuverability. There is no way that something like the Death Star could outmaneuver the Borg conventionally, and if it would be possible, there is still the warp drive of the Borg and the Picard maneuver, which they know because they assimilated enough Starfleet personnel, including the man who invented the maneuver. So what is it? Well, it's a neat trick. You switch on the warp drive, you fly just 10 kilometers or something in the flanks of your enemy, and you hit them there where they can't fight back. That's one of the big questions in Star Trek anyway. Why don't they do that non-stop? Anyway, the hyperdrive on the other hand can't be used in that way. However, the Borg are able to do that too, so there is no argument that the Borg can't dictate the angle of the fight, so the super duper laser is worthless anyway. The second thing is that the Death Star could draw a gazillion fighters on them, but sorry, all you have to shoot them down is point defense. They have no armor, no shields, and it's just a question of a low power beam weapon that would just swipe them away long before they can come into weapon range. And if they come in range, it's because the Borg let them. Then they place a Borg drone on there, let them flee and infest the Death Star. From this, it's just a question of time till the Borg have another nice tool that even fits in their geometrical doctrine of spacefight. But let's say the Empire won't use their fighters and utilize their 20,000 emplacements. Well, we have seen in the movies that most of the bigger weapons are built as central batteries, which makes them safer but limited in their angle of attack. The batteries, on the other hand, could take on the cube and would. Here we enter the question of range or not, because the Borg shield technology is able to adapt, which means that once they understood the technology, they can make their shields impenetrable to that very weapon, which is another silly concept in Star Trek. But still, if we would ask who would win, the Death Star or Harry Potter, we would have to deal with the silly stuff that Harry Potter can do. I would go a step towards common sense and say that the Borg are not able to ignore all of the damage, but just a lot of that. In any way, the Borg would keep the same attack angle the whole time, so the Death Star would be able to utilize perhaps 5 to 20% of its big guns, and with some luck, 20 to 40% of the batteries. It's still a lot of potential damage, I give you that, but the Borg are able to reduce this impact greatly by the shield technology, and since the projectiles of the so-called laser weapons of the Death Star are ridiculously slow, while the main armament of the Borg hits with light speed, the Borg have it way easier to evade while remaining a hit rate of 100%. In the end, the Borg cube would win, either by ship-to-ship combat or a successful entering mission that just take one undetected Borg drone drifting slowly through the shields. So why talk about that on a political channel? Well, first, it's fun to do something like that, and it's fun to do a different thing, and secondly, it's yet another great example of people don't understanding potentials. Just because we don't see the Picard maneuver in each and every fight scene in Star Trek, which we should, don't mean it can't be used and will not be used. Star Trek is full of unused opportunities, while Star Wars is not so much because there is not a lot of tech there. The fight between the Death Star and the Borg cube is, from my perspective, like the fight between a 16th century flagship like the San Martin against a modern small attack craft with a team of well-trained and well-equipped marines on board. Just bring 5 of them on board and they have it under control in just half an hour. Or use the far bigger maneuverability, range, rate of fire and wear them down. Or if you don't like this comparison, compare it with the fight of a middle-aged fortified city against a modern paratrooper troop and one bomber. I have the feeling that people think of military potential as just summing up the guns. It's more than that. It's way more than that. The Death Star, demolished by the Borg cube, is logical if you go into depth and will still surprise a lot of people out there because the Death Star is so pretty big. Bigger is not always better, and having the bigger gun with a lot of overkill potential don't make your victory certain. You have to get the guy first. Looking forward to a lot of hate in the comment section. Like, share and subscribe if you want more, and have a wonderful time.